Satoshi and I had... what? All my well-planned actions throughout the day turned out to have been nothing more than a reenactment of what Satoshi had done. Satoshi? Had he really been in the same situation as I was now? The friends he had gotten along with had changed suddenly and for no reason, at least none that I had noticed, planned to kill him? Then, fearing for his life as I am, he got a bat to protect himself and carried it around every day to practice his swing? And then one day, suddenly, he transferred. My blood went cold, causing a prickling sensation to course through my veins. Starting near my heart, it radiated outwards, from the top of my head to the soles of my feet, chilling every part of me without recourse. What did she mean by transfer? What did she mean by transfer? Was Satoshi still at whatever he transferred to? Or wherever? Was he the only one who would be able to understand me? Would he be able to tell me why it all ended up like this? More importantly, where did he transfer to? What did she mean by transfer? What did she mean by transfer? Before I knew it, I was at my front door. The frigid knob was hard to turn. Was nobody home? It wasn't that odd of an occurrence. I reached into my pocket and pulled out a single key attached to my first seal keychain. I stepped into the entryway just as I was about to take off my shoes. A chill ran down my spine. Someone had entered right behind me. Like a classmate messing around, standing right up against my back. You're kidding, right? It had to be my imagination. Logically speaking, it was impossible for someone to be able to hide their presence within my personal space all the way through the door. But there was undoubtedly someone behind me. Hey now, Keiichi. How do you know they're there, even though they're behind you? Because I could hear the sound of flowing hair. There's no other reason I'd hear that sound. That was the presence. Because I could hear the sound of them blinking. Keiichi, there's no way you could hear that. My most base instincts were warning me of the presence. Common sense was telling me that it was just my imagination. It was just my imagination. There was nobody behind me. I began to erase the mental image of an eerie figure standing right behind me. But at the same time, I asked myself, if there was nobody, then what was I feeling? As an uncomfortable sensation crawled up my spine. Actually, wouldn't it be better if there was somebody there? If there was nobody there when you turned around, would you be able to accept that? I'd be able to answer all those questions just by looking behind me, but I didn't have enough courage to even do that simple task. Oh, right. I could try speaking to them. The person behind me might answer me. It was a random thought. I didn't care how I went about it, just so long as I didn't have to turn around. If I had calmed down and thought about it, I would have known that wouldn't have solved anything.
Donata desu ka?
I spoke in such a hoarse, broken voice that I couldn't believe it was my own. I could almost feel them contemplating their response. I felt it. There's no way I should be able to do that. Calm down, Keiichi. It's all in your head. That time, I was certain I heard it. As if hesitantly trying to answer my inquiry, I was certain I could hear the sound of somebody inhaling. I heard it. I heard it. I heard it clearly. It was a girl. A young girl. I didn't know who, but a tiny speck of courage in me, however reckless it was, inspired a primal yet fitting solution to this current predicament. A scream. All the force in my body released from my lungs and through my throat, seizing all thought process in my head. Suppressing all my thoughts and emotions, I began to collapse like a house of cards, somehow managing to twist my body and look back as I did so. It was definitely there. Right there. Somebody was there. Until the moment I turned around, until I brought the area behind me into my field of vision, they were definitely there. Falling face up, my eyes traced the remnants of the presence suspended in the empty space. It couldn't be. They were invisible. They looked like they weren't there. But were they actually still standing there? As I screamed, all the emotions I was holding back burst free in a violent wave. However, I was decidedly calm as my emotional dam collapsed. The turbulent wave of pent-up emotions was skillfully diverted into a torrent of aggression. That emotion was definitely required to extricate myself from the bizarre situation happening right in front of myself. In my state of heightened I had a good thing running. I was going really well. I didn't even give an introduction to the episode, and then you fucked me with that word. Lucidity. I entrusted my body to the fury. The metal bat held firm in my right hand as if drawn there by a magnet. A mid-level sweep would be the hardest attack to dodge. I remembered reading something like that from a book about swordsmanship or something. I brandished my will to fight. The afterimage of the amalgamation of metal flashed as it swung left to right, beating against the entryway. The bat slammed into the right wall, the tip rebounding violently. Very calmly, I transferred the force of the rebound into a sweep to the left. The door of the shoe cupboard was split into pieces. Those two swings whiffed through empty space, but they seemed to have a great psychological impact on the enemy. I could feel the panic emanating from that space. The attack wasn't the only thing required. I extracted the bat from the cupboard it was embedded in, and screamed as I spun my entire body around in a large arc. My screams shook the air, imbuing the ferocious swing with even more destructive power. Without mercy or restraint, my violent strike, with certainly fatal force behind it, shattered the top of the cupboard. None of my attacks struck the enemy, but my ferocity had certainly seemed to impact them. Breathing heavily, my entire body soaked in sweat. The invisible enemy, there but not there, dispersed. When I was certain that the enemy had retreated, I locked the front door and latched the chain. No way had it only feigned retreat and was now inside my house. Once again, I channeled my aggression and searched the house for a presence. But it was gone. I had succeeded in fending it off. At that moment, the tension drained from my body, and I let out a deep sigh of relief. All of the emotions I'd been holding back chaotically merged together and began to flood out. A hodgepodge of fear, accomplishment, and disbelief all mixed together and began to flow through my body. Unable to deal with each individual feeling, I beat them all back with the strongest. Exhaustion. Even in this moment, I remained composed. After checking that all the doors throughout the house were locked, I went up to my room on the second floor and closed the curtains. I straightened my back and tilted my head back a little. After clearing my mind of all my idle thoughts, I managed to calm down even more. What was that at the front door? There was definitely something there. Thinking about it, maybe it was just an apparition I dreamt up in my confused state, but I really didn't think that was the case. Calm down, Keiichi. Compose yourself. But no matter how calmly I thought about it, what just happened wasn't a figment of my imagination. It was obviously a supernatural phenomenon, and without a doubt, something was behind me. It wasn't some sort of illusion I saw amidst my confusion and disorientation. Proof? I had just one piece. When I asked, "Who is it?" they inhaled as if they were about to answer. That sound had clearly reached my ears. The situation I was in right now was still unclear. Either I'd been possessed by the supernatural phenomenon known as Oyashiro-sama's curse, or this was a ruse by the villagers who believed in it and were imitating it. Either way, their motives were unclear. The roundabout way it had been done was also still a mystery. If it was perpetrated by humans, then that would mean admitting that it was Rena and the rest of them doing it. But it would be solvable. Oishi-san and the rest of the police would surely arrest my enemy. But if it was a manifestation of Oyashiro-sama's curse, I wondered what would happen. Oishi-san very clearly declared that curses didn't exist, and at that time, those words were pretty dependable. but as things were now, with the rising possibility that the perpetrators were not human, he suddenly seemed quite unreliable. If I told Oishi-san this was the work of Oyashiro-sama's curse, what would happen? I couldn't imagine his reaction, but it would go without question that a void would expand rapidly between myself and Oishi-san. With me having so few allies to begin with, and not being able to confidently declare whether or not this was a curse, there was no merit in doing that. I'd better keep the facts of what just happened at the doorway to myself. It would be better if I didn't add what happened here to the memo behind the clock. There was still the ever so slight possibility that I was actually confused when I thought I was composed, and I was just going berserk in the entryway. How wonderful would it be if that was really what happened? I would be able to refute Oyashiro-sama's curse, but if I denied Oyashiro-sama's curse, then that would mean admitting that Rena and the rest were the perpetrators. If I said that Rena and the rest weren't the perpetrators, then that would mean believing in Oyashiro-sama's curse. By denying both of those, I would be admitting that I myself was losing it. The three options from which I couldn't choose became a trilemma of sorts. They mixed together and formed a whirlpool in my mind, making my head spin. Once again, I straightened myself and leaned my head back slightly to cool myself down. "Calm down, Keiichi. Accept what has actually happened as reality. Stop thinking of anything more than that." But I couldn't help but think of it. How wonderful it would be if it turned out that I was delirious and everything up until now was a figment of my imagination. Oyashiro-sama's curse wouldn't exist and I would still be best buddies with Rena and the rest. I would have to be crazy. That was the first time in my life I'd ever wished for such a thing. I mean, I think he's the sanest person in the village right now. Holy shit, that sounded real. Okay. The phone rang noisily downstairs. Generally, there were no calls for me, so I never really answered the phone much. But since my parents weren't here, I had no choice. I squirmed off the bed and went downstairs.
Moshimoshi, Maebara desu.
Keiichi, oka-san da kedo.
You guys better be, like, at the store on your way back, because I intuitively had a bad feeling about this. It was because I thought she was going to ask me to go out and buy some things. So I took the initiative.
What? I'm not sure. I'm not sure. I'm not sure.
The other day, we went out as a family and bought a whole case of cup noodles. I wanted to get a bunch of different kinds, actually, but they refused since the individual packs were expensive. So instead, I got a whole case of the mega-sized pork bone and ginger-flavored ones I liked. What the fuck is pork bone? But my parents don't like strong flavors and didn't touch any of them, so the cupboards were still full of them. How about mommy and daddy? Don't go to Tokyo right now for work. How about you treat your son to a nice afternoon of playing marbles?
Well,
I think we're fucked. Well, gee, thanks for the warning, Mom. It's quite a distance to Tokyo from Hinamizawa. Gunning at full speed down the highway would still take 6 hours. Dad has a license, but since he doesn't like the highway, they likely took the train. It would have taken longer. Wait, does taking the train actually take longer? I would have assumed that's faster than taking a car, but I guess in a car you're continuously moving. Now that she mentioned it, I did remember that they talked all that time about how his job prospects weren't looking so good. Part of my father's particular fragile artistic personality, his emotions changed as easily as the fall sky. You could also just say he couldn't take criticism. But I'm at risk of dying. The whole fucking village is after me, Mom.
とにかく電話よりも直接会って話した方が早いの。誤解もないし。
As their son, there was nothing more I could say once they started talking about work. Yeah, that's Japan for you, I guess. No. Okay. I mean, that's pretty cute. Yesterday, I did bring up if I died rather abruptly, so I suppose they were a little worried, which is why they up and left for work to go to Tokyo the next day. But really, I was more depressed by the fact that nothing would be solved by telling them. But I didn't plan on dying, at least not while I still knew nothing. I would never allow it.
死なないよ。俺はあがいてでも生き延びる。
そう。じゃあね。明日の朝、ちゃんと起きるのよ。朝ごはんは食べてね。
Yeah, tomorrow morning, make sure you wake up, as opposed to just not.
お前の歯磨きも忘れないのよ。
Oh, for fuck's sake, now she's doing the mom thing.
Hey, hey. そんじゃ。
The call ended like that. Sometimes my parents went off to Tokyo for business meetings, but Tokyo was far away. They normally did things by phone. The times they did go were normally planned out in advance. It never happened this suddenly. I couldn't say that those circumstances didn't feel strange or rather unnatural. Anyway, I only needed to recognize the reality of the situation. That tonight, I was the only one in the house. That when my parents came back from work, I'd be gone, missing. Vanished. Looking back on the series of events of the previous 5 years involving Oyashiro-sama's curse, it wouldn't seem all that strange. Come to think of it, it was getting pretty late. I didn't think it was good that the only light out on in the whole house was from my room on the second floor. It was the same as broadcasting to the enemy that my parents were gone, and this was their chance, which is why we're currently in the dining room with the light on. First, I ran into the living room, flicked on the lights, and turned the TV on to a reassuring volume. Next was the study. I similarly turned on the lights and some music. You know, this is not too far off of how I used to when I was a kid, because I'm home alone a lot nowadays, and I'm a very paranoid person. And when I was younger, I used to turn all the lights on in the house, not because I was afraid of the dark, but because I didn't want anyone outside thinking that there was nobody home. So I literally did this when I was younger, except the whole town that I live in, despite being very small, I don't think is out to kill me yet. With this, from the outside, it would look like my parents were here. Once again, I went through the house, checking to see if there was anything left unlocked. When I saw the veranda and the laundry still hanging out there, I went pale. That would have made it too obvious. I needed to take it down. I snatched down the laundry haphazardly and erased all traces that my mother wasn't here. It should be fine now. Ah! The garage! They have a garage? They hadn't gone all the way to Tokyo by car, but they had gone up to Okinomiya Station. The garage was empty, wide open, and in plain sight. This was not good. I panicked and rushed out to the back to close the normally open garage door. It should be fine now. I need to get the paper. Mom always got the paper. Since they left in the afternoon, the evening paper was still out. What the fuck is the evening paper? What the hell? I delivered morning papers. We don't have an evening paper. Also, it is getting cold as tits. What the hell's going on here? I mean, I get that it's still winter, but... And then I also am currently not fully clothed, sitting in my bedroom playing visual novels from the early 2000s. My premonition was correct. I pulled out everything from the mailbox and dropped it in the entryway. Can you shut the fucking door? Shut the damn door! With this, for sure this time, it should be fine. Okay, there you go. Jesus. Come to think of it, leaving the cupboard busted like that for my little freakout was kind of bad. I'll just say I tripped and fell, hit my head about 14 times on it, and that the bat I was holding smashed into it. Even so, just leaving it in its current state wasn't good. I should clean it up a little before Mom got back and scolded me. I remember there was a broom and dustpan in the closet. As I was going to get them, the phone rang once again.
もしもし, 前原です。
Boy, I hope it's not Rena.
あら, ケイチ君?
What?
お母様はいらっしゃいますかしら?
あの...
I was literally expecting it to be Rena, and I thought I was being witty. But apparently, I fucked up. You idiot, Keiichi! Don't reveal that your parents are gone! You can follow up still. Calm down and take care of it. That wasn't a good response either. Now they might say they'll call again or to tell her to call them when she comes back. What the hell does a villager want with my parents? The scenario I feared didn't play out, eliciting a sigh of relief. That call was fortunate in more ways than one. I'd have to deal with any telephone calls coming in from my parents tonight. I was somehow able to deal with the phone call just now, but I couldn't continue to rely on such poor improvisation. I needed to make up a good story to explain that my parents were home, but couldn't answer the phone at the moment. They were making tempura, and couldn't step away right now. That wasn't good enough. They were sick and went to bed because they weren't feeling well. Was that going to be safe enough? I was thinking about it on the way back to my room when the phone rang once again. It was like they were calling because they knew I was going to lie. I didn't want to pick up, but I knew I had to. They'd suspect my parents weren't here. I should have just taken the phone off the hook under the pretense that I didn't realize that it was. But since the phone rang, I had to pick it up. I prepared myself and lifted up the receiver.
もしもし?
I stopped announcing this was the Maibara residence. I had no reason to be kind to someone I didn't know the identity of. But unlike my But unlike my uncouth voice, the person on the other side sounded goofy and lighthearted. It's Oishi! Stop fucking baiting me thinking that it was Rena because it was the Rena music.
Oishi-san desu ka? Maibara-san desu ka? Konbanwa. Ogenkiso de nani yori desu.
Chotto matte kudasai ne.
Oh, he's going to take the call up to his room. I grabbed the portable handset and rushed up to my room with it. It was the same no matter where I was since there was no one else home, but I wanted to be in a spot that felt just a bit safer when speaking on the phone with Oishi-san.
お待たせしました.
いかがですか? そのおかわりは?
Since then, when was that exactly? There was something about the brazen way he talked that rubbed me the wrong way. The last time I spoke with Oishi-san was 2 days ago. The day I stayed home from school, I met Oishi-san on the way back from the hospital, and we headed into town for- That was 2 days ago? That was a full year ago for me, you prick! Then after that, Rena and Mion came to check on me. Whenever I spoke with Oishi-san, they always knew about it. It was like that since the first time I met him. Today's phone call may well be found out by them as well.
もしもし? 聞こえてますか? Maibara-san.
すみません。その、なんて言いました?
その後、何か変わったことはありませんか? とお尋ねしたんです。お返事がないんで焦りましたよ。
特には…
The word stopped in my throat. There was a ton of stuff that happened. All of it baffling. What should I talk about? I didn't understand any of it, but I shouldn't try asking. Or I should try asking. If I didn't ask now, I may never have another chance. This night when my parents weren't home, I had no guarantees I would make it through the night safely after all.
その、大石さん、やっぱり俺、命を狙われているみたいです。本当ですか？偶然の可能性もあるんですが、先日俺が病気で休んだ日、夕方にあの二人がお見舞いに来たんです。あの二人？レナとミオンです。そしてそこで、 大石さんと一緒に昼飯を食ったことを忠されました。それで、お見舞いってことでおはぎを置いていったんです。その中に針が入ってたんです。偶然飲み込まずに済みましたが、これってやっぱり脅迫でしょうか？その針は、よく見かけるような普通の裁縫針のようでした。
糸を通す穴が開いていて。違いますよ、前原さん。針です。証拠になります。脅迫だと立証できるかもしれません。その針はありますか?
That's right. That's it! I dropped the receiver and rushed downstairs. When I tossed the mochi, I had overlooked it out of terror, but that needle was a valuable piece of evidence. Let's see, I threw the mochi and needle at the wall together. If it was there, then it would be in the living room wall. On the living room wall. It's not the living room! That's the kitchen! but my prudent mother had cleaned that living room wall, and there was not a trace of mochi left on it. Could it be that it dropped it in the gap between the wall and the carpet? That's very much a hard floor, like a tile floor, not a carpet. I can see that these backgrounds might not line up with what the original did. I frantically searched by running my palm along the carpet, but nothing turned up. Ooh, that's a great way to poke yourself if it was down there. I tried moving around the sofa and whenever there's like, because I have cats, so sometimes if there's a pokey thing in the carpet, I mean, I'm not a professional, but I just find the best way to do it without brushing your hand across to, you know, end up stabbing yourself is to dab the carpet lightly and gently until you press up against like a staple or something. Not rub your hand like a dumbass, because then you're going to end up slicing into your finger with it. I tried moving around the sofa and desks, pulling up the carpet, then flapping it around. But I couldn't find the needle. Did my mom clean up everything without noticing it? It was just 2 days ago. I didn't know what day they collected the burnable trash, but it may still be in the trash bin in the kitchen. I rushed into the kitchen, which is definitely not where we were just at, opened up the lid of the pail, and poured out the contents. But even at a glance, I could tell that it would be incredibly difficult to find the needle in this pile of trash. I was looking for a needle in a trash stack. Literally. I know. I'll try running my hand through it. It was a bit gross, but I was looking for a needle. If I felt a small prick, I'll be able to find it. It was a pretty tactless method, but it was the quickest. I held my breath and started striking the pile of trash with my hand. Filth flew about. There was nothing more disgusting than this, but it was not the time to be concerned about such details. I continued on for a while, but nothing turned up. I wanted to search more thoroughly, but I was still on the phone. I shouldn't keep Oishi-san waiting for too long. Later, when Mom got back, I'd have to ask her if there was a needle. I hastily began scribbling on the notepad affixed to the refrigerator with a magnet. Was there a needle? I scrawled the words with a red pen. I then dashed back up the stairs where I had been keeping Oishi-san waiting for far too long.
Moshimoshi, dou deshita ka?
Mitsukarimasen. Ano toki wa tsui ki ga douten shite ite.
Sou desu ka. Mitsukareba de ii desu. Okan shite oite kudasai ne.
That's right. The needle wasn't the only incident. I had to tell him about this morning with the hit and run.
Ato Oishi-san, sore dake janai desu. Jitsuwa kesa.
That van was definitely aiming for me. I could say that without question due to the circumstances at the time.
その車のナンバープレートは見ましたか? こちらでも探してみます。
Damn it! At the time, I just flipped out yelling at him, but I didn't look at the plate. What failure is on my part with the needle and the plate number? I was so focused just protecting myself that I let some of the most important details slip out of my grasp. I punched my pillow, annoyed at how worthless I was.
すみません。白いワゴン車ってこと以外は分かりません。
仕方ないことですよ、前原さん。惹かれかければ気も動転します。
やっぱりこれだって偶然じゃないですよね。
Oishi-san started to hem and haw over on the other end. I could imagine him folding his arms.
あと、レナの様子もやっぱり怪しいです。
それはどんな感じですか?
What Rena said on the way home today, asking why I was so much like Satoshi-kun. Now I could say it with confidence that Rena knew what happened to Satoshi. She knew that there was more to it than him just simply disappearing.
レナは知っています。去年の鬼隠しにあったサトシのことを何か知っています。
それは具体的にどういうことですか?
レナが言うには俺はサトシとそっくりらしいんです。このまま行くと、俺もサトシと同じ運命をたどると、そんな感じのことを言うんです。
運命ですか。具体的にどんな運命をたどるか言及しましたか。
天候と。
天候?
レナは、サトシは転校したって言ってるんです。で、俺もこのままだと転校しちゃうぞって。
Oishi-san let out a stern sigh and then grumbled loudly.
前原さん、それはおそらく何かの脅迫、もしくは警告ですね。
俺もそう思ってます。
At that point, I started to think, would it be prudent to sum up everything that had happened up until now as the machinations, okay, of a human perpetrator? Other than the theory of it being Rena and the others, I was left with Oyashiro-sama's curse actually existing as the only explanation. Of course, I couldn't tell that to Oishi-san. Except, Rena's strange behavior could be proof of either scenarios. Whether it was Oyashiro-sama's curse being real or everything being part of a conspiracy committed by all of the villagers. Rena was involved. Rena had to know something. Rena was suspicious. What exactly was Rena? I couldn't help but think she was somehow involved with the prior string of mysterious deaths. I seem to recall that Oishi-san had admitted that he had dug into Rena's past a little. He was probably just downplaying it when he said a little, meaning he had actually dug pretty deep, most likely. I wanted to hear about Rena. I wanted to know what happened at her previous school, among other things that were still known to me, unknown to me. If Rena was somebody I should suspect, no, not that. I wanted to know the truth. Tonight, I was alone in this huge house. Even though I said I couldn't count on them, I had lost the security I felt I had just by my parents being around. It wasn't like this house was some sort of fortress or castle. If a malicious person decided to use brute force, they'd easily gain entry. There were no other residents close to the Maibara residence. No one would be able to hear anything, no matter how loud it was. I had never felt as much resentment towards my father's artistic temperament and the fact that he had this house built in such a remote location as I did right now. I wondered if I would still... What the hell? So I had to ask. Right now. Because I had no idea when the next chance would come. What is the ding-donging? Hello, somebody's at your door.
隠さないでくださいね。
ええ、何でも聞いてください。
Even though he was so far away on the other end of the line, this was the most reliable he had ever felt. I wanted to ask about Rena, about what happened at her previous school.
実は、レナの。
I noticed a sound that had been going on for a while now.Since I was so focused on the call, I hadn't paid attention to it at first, but I finally realized... Oh, fuck. It was the doorbell. The time was 7 o'clock. It was past the time that postman would be making a delivery, and past any sensible time for a neighbor to be visiting. I considered just acting like nobody was home, but that wouldn't be good. That would ruin all the work I put into making it look like my parents were home. I need to answer the door.
もしもし、前原さん?
すみません。誰か来たみたいですので、ちょっと玄関に行ってきます。
お客さんですか。すみません、すみません。今夜のお電話はこれくらいにしましょうか。
That would be a problem.
いえ、すぐ戻りますから。電話はこのままでいいですか。
はいはい、構いませんよ。
I dropped the handset on my bed and dashed down to the door. I needed to make up a good excuse to get them to leave.I had a hunch it was the lady who called right before Oishi-san did. In which case, it would be one of the neighbors who's friends with my mom. I'll just say mom isn't feeling well and went to bed early. That would be the easiest option. It'd be hard for her to ask me to wait. Jesus, fight. You know, if you ring the doorbell, you son of a bitch, and nobody comes and you ring it again just in case and nobody comes, get the fuck out of here. Nobody's coming to the door. Just fuck off.Maybe they're sleeping, maybe they're sick, maybe they're not even home. That's why if you ring the doorbell and nobody comes to the door, you get the fuck out. Okay, you piece of shit. I'm looking at you, Domino's delivering guy or whatever, that one night when I said leave it on the porch and you stayed at the door for like 15 minutes and my pizza was cold. The bell continued to ring at regular intervals. If someone didn't answer after you rang the bell so much, you'd normally give up and go home, wouldn't you? What the hell did I just say?Without removing the chain, I opened the door slightly and peered out at the visitor. How about you don't do that? How about you use the fucking hole that's on the door and peek out that first? Not open the door and peek over, you know, through the little opening slit. A chill ran down my spine. I knew it. Somewhere deep inside, I had prepared for this moment. I had tried to escape by imagining it was the easiest person to deal with, one of my mom's friends.
Konbanwa.
Oh, hell!
Rena.
There shouldn't be any reason for Rena to come over at this hour. The timing also made me feel uneasy, because it was just as I was about to ask Oishi-san about Rena. I wish I could have chalked this up to mere coincidence, but those unsettling words from Mion several days ago echoed back to me.
さてね、おじさんにわからないことはないからね。
レナ一人？
うん。
It seems that Mion wasn't with her, but that didn't change the situation at all.
何しに来たんだよ。
ねえ、ケイチ君、ちゃんとドアを開けてお話ししたいな。レナは玄関に入っちゃダメなのかな？かな？
It was true that speaking through a chained door wasn't the right way to talk to a classmate, but...
うち、夜は必ずチェーンかけてるんだよ。気にすんなよ。
なら、仕方ないかな。
Rena looked at the ground sadly, but she kept smiling at least, and her effort to keep that smile up was quite pitiful. Even though she was tugging at my heartstrings, I didn't lower my guard. As long as I stayed like this, even if it made my heart ache, my life wasn't in danger. What I really feared, more than the possibility that hoodlums would assault me if I removed the chain, was trusting Rena enough to remove the chain and having my friendship betrayed. As long as the chain wasn't unlatched, even if it made my heart ache, I wouldn't have to deal with being betrayed by Rena. Since it didn't seem like I'd remove the chain from her silent urging, she appeared to give up on trying to get into the entranceway.
あのさ、ケイチ君、ご飯食べた？
No, I haven't eaten. Since my mom wasn't there, dinner wouldn't be ready no matter how long I waited. I laid down when I got home, I was woken up by the phone, and didn't have a chance to eat since I used up all that time talking. I was going to have a cup of noodles, I was going to have cup noodles in any case. I could just eat one whenever I wanted to.
まだだよ。それがどうしたよ。
じゃあよかった。これ見て。お惣菜とか持ってきてあげたの。
Rena held out a stack of boxes wrapped in a cloth.
お台所とか貸してくれれば、お味噌汁も温めてあげられるよ。
いいよ、そこまでしてくれなくても。
でもでも、お豆腐もお野菜もたっぷりなの。
Ew.
ケイチ君、そういうの嫌いかな？かな？
Yeah. I mean, I've never had tofu, so I don't know what that's like. But vegetables, it depends on what kind. There's no way I wouldn't like that. I'm a man, I eat all my vegetables. I love miso soup with lots of ingredients. White radish, carrots, burdock root, and potatoes. Dense and fibrous root vegetables.Yeah, that miso soup sounds like it tastes like dirt.
ご飯も持ってきてあげたから、レンジで温めればすぐ食べられるし。
Without a doubt, rice needs miso soup. Stuffing rice down your gullet, sipping miso soup in between ravenous bites. Oh, how wonderful it is to be born Japanese. I wouldn't know, I've never had miso soup. And rice I never have had with soup of any type, actually, come to think of it.But this is also the way somebody who is super hungry would talk or think.
それからね、またお漬物を作ってきたんだよ。
You made more pickles? How do you make pickles? I mean, I think I remember this being talked about earlier. I guess she just brines her own pickle.
今度は山菜のお漬物なの。
I don't know what senzai pickles are. Before I had moved here to Hinamizawa, I scoffed at the mountain vegetables called senzai. Sanzai, I guess.But I was captivated by their charm the first time I tried them. Such a deep yet light flavor. Those so-called supermarket vegetables taste rough and overpowering in comparison. If you had to describe them, then they were the vegetables for the uninitiated. To become an expert such as myself, you first had to partake of sanzai. It was common knowledge around here that the Rugu family, traditional pickles were wonderfully delicious.No matter what kind of pickles they were, they'd go so well with that fluffy white rice.
それからね、それからね。
But wait, there's more. So delicious. It just seems so delicious. Farewell to my unhealthy self who said he'd make do with cup noodles. Rena appeared to be in good spirits, and she was offering such a delicious sounding dinner. The stress evaporated from my gut, and hunger reared its ferocious head. At the same time, my wariness of Rena suddenly dwindled.Rena did say she was alone. It shouldn't be a problem letting her inside. though the possibility that it was laced with poison still had to be ruled out. At the moment, a cold chill ran down my spine once again. I couldn't understand why such a sensation had occurred just then, but the voice inside me was sounding the alarm. This happy Rena, speaking of this charming dinner, was dependent on one premise, and that premise was that tonight, dinner hadn't been made at my house, meaning it was under the assumption that my mom, who should be making it, wasn't here. At my normal household, 7 o'clock would be around the middle of dinner time. If my mom were here, we'd be eating dinner around this time as well. The fact that she brought over all the makings of a meal at this time was inherently strange. Unless she knew. Rena, did she? Did she know that my parents weren't home? But there was also the chance that this was a bluff. I had turned on the lights and a bunch of other stuff to make it seem like my parents were here. There was a chance that Rena was unsure if my parents were home. But I had to wonder. The laundry, the garage, the evening paper, there were plenty of signs of them being hastily tidied up. It was hard to say that Rena didn't have a chance to determine if my parents were here or not. But there was no reason for me to confess that right now. I should try holding on to the fact that as long as I could. First of all, the chain was still latched. As long as I didn't take it off, Rena wouldn't be able to do anything to me.
ありがたいんだけどさ、 もう少しで夕飯ができるみたいなんだよ。
え?そうなの? そうなの?
せっかくで申し訳ないんだけどさ、 その…
Unable to think of a good way to refuse, my words trailed off weakly.
でも、ちょっとはおかずになると思うな。思うな。悪いけど、間に合ってるよ。うちのおふくろってさ、結構おかずをいっぱい作るんだよ。だから…
Keiichi. Keiichi, my boy. You don't lie to Rena.
え?おかずあるの?
With a smile that bordered on a cringe, I dodged her questions apologetically. But the feeling I tried to ignore began creeping up my back again. I spoke as if my mom was setting down dinner right now, but it didn't mesh well with what Rena was saying. Rena was talking as if she was aware of some obvious fact, and that, I was aware of it as well.
Keiichi-kun mo okazu toka tsukureru nda ne. Nani wo tsukutta no kana?
Cup
noodle?
Betsu ni ore ga...
Rena had assumed out of nowhere that I had made the dishes. No, not so much that I'd made them, but rather that my mom hadn't.
You're
just digging the hole deeper, Keiichi.
今。だからさ、悪いけど、レナの持ってきてくれたのは…
Rena fell silent at that moment. At that moment, I felt the light had suddenly disappeared from her eyes. The conversation might appear natural at first glance, but Rena was firmly in control. It felt like I was being interrogated. You're not gonna say it has noodle in it.
おい、侮るなよ。うちのおふくろのスペシャルなディナーを見くびるなってんだ。それはもう、満願前席状態で、すごいのなんの。
I tried my best to put on a strong front, but I couldn't grit my teeth quite right. So instead, I looked like someone who was borderline hysterical. But Rena showed no reaction whatsoever, even to that silliness.
Keiichi-kun, 本当にお母さん, ご飯作ってってくれたの?
いや、だから、くれたんじゃなくて, 今作ってるんだよ!
Keiichi...
もうすぐ晩飯に!
Rena had taken that assertion of mine, that my mother was home and making dinner right now, and was completely ignoring it. I could tell that the more I panicked, the colder Rena became.
Keiichi-kun.
I don't like where this is going. At that moment, an uncomfortable chill crept in from the gap in the doorway.
お母さん、お家にいるのかな？かな？
I couldn't keep up the charade anymore. Rena, she knew full well that my parents weren't home. But I'd come too far to admit that now. Anyway, my parents were here, and we'd be having dinner soon. That was the situation I had concocted. So I answered. I told her she was here.
いるよ。もちろん。
I could feel the humidity drying out from the surrounding air. Rena's eyes were becoming even more frigid, piercing me with their... glare. What?
どうして?
It always has to get Higurashi, doesn't it?
え?何のことかな?
I tried acting casual, but that facade was torn off me the instant I looked into Rena's eyes. That look, it informed me of Rena's response faster than she could open her mouth.
どうしてさっきから嘘をつくのかな? かな?
嘘なんか?
嘘だよね?
嘘なんかじゃ...
嘘だよ!
Rena's outburst sent a jolt surging through my body. Rena and I were still separated by a few inches that slightly ajar, but still chained door could afford. But despite that, I was still being cornered. My house, which I'd considered a safe haven until now, had become more like a dark alleyway where no one could save me.
Keiichi-kun no yuhan... 当てるよ?
I knew now that Rena had already known that my parents were not here tonight. But it was still so strange that it had come to this. Even if she somehow knew that my parents weren't home, there was no way she would be able to guess what I'd be eating tonight. But Rena said she'd guess. How could she guess it? How could she know it was instant?
カップラーメン. 当たりでしょ?
That I was going to eat. Wait a minute. The cooking repertoire of a man who can't do housework is probably nothing but cup noodles after all. Looking at this statistically, it was the most probable answer. That didn't mean she was guessing.
ラーメンだけじゃきっとお腹すくと思うな。ご飯とかも一緒の方がきっと腹持ちいいと思うよ。
Calm down, Keiichi. This was just a coincidence. Rena was just reading certain tales of mine, so the fact that she was inferring what I was thinking alarmed me. But it wasn't as if she was actually reading my mind. If she was being read, then she was a demon. If it was being read, damn it, then she was being a demon. No, not a demon. Things like that, they couldn't possibly exist.
好きなの?
They're like, what, demons?
ラーメンが、かよ。
Oh, right.
Mm-hmm. 豚骨生姜味.
Okay, now I have to figure out what the fuck she said. I tried listening to what she said, but I didn't recognize the word in Japanese. Did she say demons? D-E-M-O-N-S, no. K-I-L-L-I-N-G, maybe? But she didn't say anything about dying. Rena indicated that the point my answer was addressing was wrong. Her rebuttal was so short that I momentarily didn't understand the words Rena had spoken.
ごめん、レナ。今、なんて?
Oh, maybe that was the point, that we weren't supposed to know what she said.
え?何が?
今さ、何が好きって聞いたんだよ?
It wasn't long before I regretted how carelessly I'd pushed forward with that question. It was such a simple answer. That was why I wasn't able to comprehend it.
豚骨生姜味
How she would know that? I don't know. Maybe she just likes us a lot, and so she knows everything we like. I wondered how I appeared in the moments my mind went completely blank until the moment I was able to recover. As my field of view began to distort, slowly swirling in a counterclockwise direction, I lost all sense of balance.
なんでそこまでわかるんだよ!
I didn't even deny it. That was the type of frenzied state I was in. How could Rena know even this? Not even caring as I mashed my head against the door, I fixated my gaze on Rena. But she didn't even flinch when she saw me do that.
確かに勝った! まとめて勝った! 俺が箱買いした! それがどうしてわかるんだ!
なんでかな? 不思議だね。だね。
How could you dodge the question at a time like this? The chain and the door suddenly were no longer protecting me.
どうしてわかる?なぜ知ってる?答えろ!
買ったのはセブンスマートだよね?
A shiver ran up my spine. I tried covering it up with an angry facade.
だから、なんでわかるんだよ!
ケイチ君の後ろ、ずっとくっついてたから。
So she is the one.
何を言ってんだよ?
I couldn't understand why she was saying she'd been following me all this time.
だから、レナがケイチ君の後ろにずっとくっついてたの。
Like that night? That night I was absorbed in my phone conversation with Oishi-san, I didn't even sense her being there, standing behind the door, behind me, standing there, just like that.
ケイチくんがいろんなラーメン選んでるとこ、後ろからずっと見てたの。いろんな種類を選んでたんだよね。それでお母さんに怒られたの。高いラーメンばっかり選ぶから、一種類にしなさいって。それでケイチくん、 大好きな大きいカップの豚骨生姜味を選んだんだよね。レナも好きだよ、豚骨ラーメン。でも、大きいカップは全部食べきれないけどね。My
brain was paralyzed, dulling my senses. It might have been a defense mechanism to diminish the fear I was feeling to non-traumatizing levels. With the fear being diminished, the fog enveloping my mind was cleared away. Then I could understand what Rena was saying and started to put meaning behind her words. Even so, my fear hadn't subsided completely. It was like I was standing at the edge of a cliff, eyes closed so I didn't have to look down. It didn't actually solve any of the basic problems. I slowly took a step backwards, and as I withdrew, Rena advanced.
だから、ケイチ君、ここを開けて。レナと一緒にご飯食べよう。きっと美味しいから。ね?
Doesn't gohan mean rice? I guess she did say that. Oh, okay. You're getting a little bit too close there, Rena. If you would just take a step back and maybe I'll unlock the door for you. Rena's pale, slender fingers squirmed through the crack in the door one at a time, as if they had a mind of their own rattling the chain. If she had unlatched the chain from the door, a feeling of terror would have just exploded within me. But Rena didn't do that. She was simply imploring me to remove the chain. I tried my hardest to light the fuse to the powder keg in my heart, trying again and again. But it doesn't light. It doesn't light.
Okete, Keiichi-kun.
Kaette kure. Tanomu kara. Kaette kure.
Doushite sonna ijiwaru o yuu no kana? Kana?
Kaette kure. Kaereyo.
The powder keg inside me finally went off. No smoldering, it just exploded. I tackled the door. The force through the door had knocked Rena momentarily off balance. I couldn't hesitate here. I grabbed onto the doorknob with both hands, planted my feet firmly, and pulled with all my might. But that slamming sound I so desired didn't happen. I could feel a tiny, disturbing bit of resistance keeping the door from closing. And that source of that was Rena's fingers. Each of those fingers wriggling, squirming around like the tendrils of a carnivorous plant through the crack in the doorway. It wasn't a harsh shriek, but more of a yelp she was trying to keep back. I kept on pulling on the door with all my might. I didn't even realize that if I didn't loosen my pull on the door, at least momentarily, Rena wouldn't be able to pull her fingers out, and that was why the door wasn't closing. I didn't care one bit for her apology. No matter how much she apologized, it didn't change any of what she had done up until now. It didn't change anything. Rena couldn't leave, even if she wanted to, because I trapped her fingers. Rena's white fingers had become deep red and were no longer even squirming.
Gomen nasai.
Rena's apologies were occasionally twisted with pain, but like a broken record, she was intent on repeating it over and over. Go away, go away, go away, stop it, stop it, stop it. I pulled on the door even harder. Finally, Rena's fingers were somehow able to slip out from their imprisonment in the doorway. The moment that happened, the door closed soundly, and I could hear the thud of Rena falling onto her butt on the other side. I locked the door immediately and made a loud clunk, voicing my rejection to Rena. Rena leaned against the door, apologizing profusely and nothing else. After confirming that I was sufficiently sealed off from her, I trudged away from the entryway. On the other side, I could still hear Rena echoing her apology. I'm sorry, those pitiful words. They would be forever seeking my forgiveness. I didn't feel about it at all this time. I didn't feel bad about it at all this time. But that wasn't out of any sort of malice. I just felt a sort of hazy sense of relief that I was able to escape from Rena. Before, Mion had threatened me at this doorway, saying that there was nothing she didn't know. And just now, at the same place, Rena had told me the same thing. My feeble attempts to disguise the fact my parents weren't home had severed on no purpose from the start. Served no purpose. I should have just pretended to be out and not even opened the door. My meager plans hadn't helped at all. In Hinamizawa, it was impossible to outwit them. Even though I was on the other side of the door, I wanted to get as far away from Rena as possible. One step, two steps. With each one, her sniveling apologies, or sniveling apologies, became more distant. I sprinted up the stairs and dove into my room. As you would expect, I was finally no longer able to hear Rena repeating her endless apology. Diving into my bed, I was startled by the hard lump I felt. There was something in my bed? Is it the phone you left there? It was the receiver. I finally remembered. I was in the middle of a call with Oishi-san. Looking at the clock, apparently not much time had passed since I went downstairs. Could it be that my clock had run out of batteries? I had talked with Rena for so long, how did almost no time pass? But the hand on the clock was ticking forward 1 second every second as usual. As I put the still warm receiver to my ear, time, which felt frozen, began moving once again.
Oishi-san, お待たせしてすみませんでした。
いえいえ、大してお待ちしていませんよ。
It became apparent that the amount of time that had passed between myself and Oishi-san was different. Over the phone, I could hear an energetic voice from a sports program or something. It drove home just how far away Oishi-san really was.
今、レナが来ました。
And then happy Rena music.
遊びに来たんですか?
I wasn't confident that I could coherently explain the situation to Oishi-san, but I didn't need to right now. Right now, I needed to know about Rena. That's right, I was planning to ask Oishi-san more about Rena, but Rena's little visit had interrupted the conversation. What was true and what was false, I couldn't tell. The one thing I knew was the single grim reality that Rena was suspicious. I might be able to figure something out if I asked Oishi-san about her. Up until now, I had regretted it whenever I forced myself to ask about things that I was better off not knowing. But looking at it that way, you could say I'd hit rock bottom. There was no possible way I could feel any more regret than I did just now. No, rather, I wanted to know if there was anything beyond this that I would forget about tomorrow. It wasn't out of the realm of possibility for something to happen tonight. I wanted to know everything I could. I was absolutely not going to die like this. Not without knowing anything. I definitely won't.
リュウ・レナさんのことですか?調べましたよ。
I understood that Oishi-san was talking in circles. A bit meant I dug so deep it'd be hard to discuss with you since you're her friend.
その簡単なすべてを知りたいんです。
あなたが聞いて面白いような話はありませんよ。
Oishi-san.
I spoke as calmly as possible to Oishi-san, who was continuing to avoid the issue, and then I said,
リュウグー・レナは怪しいと思っています。過去の事件がたとえお社様のたたりによるものだったにせよ、リュウグー・レナは関わっています。
レナさんが怪しいと思える。具体的な証拠があるのですか?
The manner in which Oishi-san spoke became very firm. Do you have some sort of proof? That was him talking as a detective.
状況証拠だけです。
そうですか。
I could tell even over the phone how disappointed Oishi-san was.Pulling on the fishing line when he felt a bite, only to reel in the bait. Disappointed, but ready to cast the line once more, that's how it seemed.
Oishi-san, 目に見える証拠がなければ動けないんですか?
What I meant was, you can't come and save me without proof. I stuck that barb in there. As Oishi-san loved roundabout ways of saying things, he understood me just fine.
大丈夫ですよ、前原さん。あなたは私が守ります。
What a man. That was not the least bit reassuring. Oishi-san was just using me to continue his investigation. I was just going to get killed, and my corpse would be an important piece of evidence. That was all I was to him.
Oishi-san の捜査は俺の生死と無関係でしょうが、俺は死ねば終わりなんです。
Oishi-san went silent on the other end of the line. That may have been too blunt, but I didn't care. All I needed to relay to Oishi-san was that I was currently in a very dangerous position.
だから、話してください、レナのこと。サトシは転校しました。多分、俺もそれほど遠くない将来、レナの言う転校をするでしょう。ですが、大石さんには、俺の死体を見つけることもできないでしょうね。現にサトシの死体だって、まだ見つけられてない。
前原さん、どうか落ち着いて。
I was already suppressing my agitation, even without Oishi-san having to tell me. It wouldn't solve anything if I continued to scream about my mistrust in the police. It would seem that I could only depend on myself and the bat Satoshi left behind to protect myself. Then I, at least, wanted to know what happened before Rena transferred schools. The music says otherwise, Oishi-san.Oishi-san, realizing my resolve couldn't be swayed, finally caved.
今の俺にとってつまらない話は何一つありません。お願いします。
まず、いくつかお断りすることがあります。
はい。
他言無用でお願いします。また、内容には一部憶測も含まれているかもしれません。すべてが真実ではないかもしれないということです。よろしいですね。
真実ではないかもしれない。言ってる意味がよくわかりません。
雛見沢の連続開始事件は捜査本部がありません。毎年の事件はここに扱われています。ですから、竜宮レナが捜査線に浮上したことは一度もないのです。つまりですね。
レナの調査は警察としてでなく、個人として行ったということですか?
ご理解いただけて助かります。話のほとんどは電話、もしくは会って聞かせてもらったものばかりです。ですから、裏が取れていません。鵜呑みにしないでほしい、ということなんですよ。ご理解いただけますね。
全部、聞いた話だけなんですか?
ええ、申し訳ないです。個人調査ですのでね。
あれ?以前、レナのカルテを見たって言いませんでしたか?確かにそう聞きましたよ。
Oishi-san paused for a moment on the other end of the line.
そんなことも言いましたかね。気のせいということにしてください。
I didn't care about Oishi-san having certain obligations and responsibilities. I also didn't care if there was no proof. Even if they were just rumors, there's no smoke without fire after all.
話してください。Oishi-san.
わかりました。
Oishi-san finally opened those tight lips of his. It seemed that Rena lived in Hinamizawa a long time ago. She had moved to Ibaraki Prefecture just before starting elementary school. Then, following that, right after transferring, the unfortunate incident with the breaking of the school windows happened. Then Rena confided to the doctor. It was Oyashiro-sama. This was everything I knew.
私が知る話も前原さんと大きくは変わりません
では、どこを詳しく調べたんですか
I didn't need to ask. It was the incident right before she transferred back to Hinamizawa.
レナが起こした事件と、その後の医者での告白ですね。
はい。
大石さんは、その内容を知っているからこそ、レナたちを疑っているんですね。
ええ、疑っています。
やはり。レナたちが犯人
ああ、いえ、疑うとはそういう意味ではないんです。
Oishi-san was the type of person to say things with confidence, but these particular words were less than reassuring.
じゃあ、何を疑ってるんですか?
Oyashiro-sama... ですよ.
What?
Eh? Oyashiro-sama no tatari tte... 本当にあるのかな? なんてまあ...
What? Oishi-san's laugh was quite dry, certainly not the kind that would make you want to join in. Oishi-san resumed the conversation. About the dubious circumstances behind Satoshi's disappearance, the course of events leading him to delve into Rena's past. Just then, there was thunder in the distance, and a heavy rain started pouring down. It came without warning, a downpour fiercely beating the ground. I'd left the window in my room open a crack to let the heat out. The violent wind danced into my room, making the curtains flap wildly. It's not ominous at all. I got up while still on the phone and grasped the window.
この辺りがどうも関係者皆さん口が重いんですよ。被害者の一人は片目に後遺症を残すぐらい殴られているのにもかかわらずです。学校側か、もしくは表沙汰になるのを望まない何者かがいろいろ根回しをしたのかもしれませんね。またカウンセリングを担当した神経科医も職業倫理に厳格な方で。 もしもし? 前原さん?聞こえてます?
There was the figure of a person standing by the light near the mailbox this whole time. Even in this torrential rain, they didn't have an umbrella. They were unquestionably drenched from head to toe. In this shower, which more resembled a waterfall, droplets of water dripped down from her hair. Just standing there, both arms dangling at her side. In one hand was the stack of boxes wrapped in cloth. Her eyes focused on my room, focused on me as I was about to close the window. Her mouth was methodically repeating a chewing motion. It was as if she had something hard to chew in her mouth, with her cheeks puffing out. What could she be eating over there? How could it be that at this time I was more enthralled by Rena instead of the shocking developments being brought to light by Oishi-san? If it hadn't started raining, I wouldn't have gone to the window. Then I wouldn't have noticed Rena, nor would I have noticed that. Rena's mouth was moving in the same pattern. She wasn't eating something, she was repeating something. What was it? What was she repeating? To me? What was she saying? And why was I, right up against the window, fixated on
her? もしもし?前原さん? 聞こえてますか? もしもし?
ごめんなさい。
え?前原さん?
ごめんなさい。ごめんなさい。ごめんなさい。ごめんなさい。ごめんなさい。ごめんなさい。ごめんなさい。
もしもし? 前原さん? どうしましたか?
Even in this torrential downpour, Rena was still apologizing. Look at her fingers, that's fucked up. The other self inside me drew the curtain hastily with my right hand, blocking my view of the outside. But even doing that, Rena's relentless apology still reached my ears. I'm sorry. I'm sorry. I'm sorry. I'm sorry. If I forgive you for this, will you forgive me for that? Please stop. Please stop. Please stop. Please stop. I'm sorry. 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 Damn it! Why should I have to forgive her? I'm the one who wants to be forgiven. What part of me can't you forgive? I won't be killed. If you won't forgive me, then I won't forgive you either. I won't forgive. 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 Won't forgive.
前原さん、聞こえてるなら返事をしてください。もしもーし。